God is a relational God. He wanted a family, so He gave us His Son. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. And it is because He had such a desire for a family. He sowed His seed, which was His Son, and He gained many sons and daughters. It is His desire to be in relationship with every one of us. I'm going to reveal to you some strategies and some divine connections concerning the planning and the calling of God's purpose in your life in this season. So don't go anywhere. I'll be right back in a moment.
Destiny Calls is brought to you by Cornerstone International Ministries, Pastor Sylvester and Ursula Murphy.
Cornerstone International Ministries with Pastor Sylvester and Ursula Murphy invites you and your family to worship with us Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. in Opelousas, Louisiana, or Sunday mornings at 11 a.m. in Ville Platte, Louisiana. We also invite you to come out to our Wednesday night Bible studies at either campus at 7 o'clock p.m. Cornerstone International Ministries, where we are empowering people one mind at a time.
God has a plan, and His plan is always working. And you and I, friend, are a part of the divine plan and will and purpose of God in the earth realm. God is going to develop us and equip us and prepare us so that we can be able to walk out and fulfill the plan, the purpose, and the destiny for our lives. God in this season is going to use people. In order for God to fulfill His will in the earth realm through you and I, He is going to use people. And what we must understand is that God always uses people. You're not going to get where you are going by yourself. The Bible gives us several accounts on people that God uses to get us where we need to be in Him. We see in the scripture how that God used Eli to prepare Samuel to be the prophet of the nation. We see also where God used Elijah to prepare Elisha to also walk in a prophetic mantle and giftings. We also see where God used Naomi to get Ruth to her Boaz. He uses people. God even used Saul, who was a wicked king, to position David for his kingdom. And so, friend, if God is going to get the glory out of your life and take you to the place that He has destined for your life, you have to understand that He is going to use people. The scripture declares in Proverbs 20 and 18, every person is established by counsel. Every purpose is established by counsel. What does that mean? That simply means this, that God will have the right advisors and the right people in strategic places that can walk you through your process and that can get you to your destiny. The scripture also declares in Proverbs 15 and 22, it says, without counsel, without advisors, without people of wisdom in our lives, our purpose is frustrated. Our purpose is disappointed. And so we see here, friend, that God is going to use somebody to get you where you need to go. You can't get there by yourself. You will not arrive there alone. God has strategically purposed and planned people that is getting ready to surround your life and getting ready to give you the proper counseling, the proper advice, and everything you need to get where you are going. Otherwise, your purpose is frustrated. Your purpose will be disappointing. You can never reach your maximized potential in God except God surrounds you with the right kind of people. It goes on to say this, that, but in the multitude of counselors, our purpose is established. Now, if God is going to establish establish you in the earth realm, and if God is going to fulfill the promises in your life, it is going to take a circle of people. In the multitude of counsel, your purpose is established. And so I want to say once again, friend, that you have got to look for those God connections in this season. Look for the people that God is getting ready to surround you with so that he can fulfill his ultimate plan in your life. And God told me to prophetically speak to you on this morning and tell you that he is building you a team. That's right. He told me to tell you that he is preparing a team of people that has the resources you need, that has the wisdom you need, that knows what you don't know, that has been where you haven't been, but have everything that it takes to get you to the place you need to be. And so he is building you a team, getting ready to surround you with advisors and people that can esteem you and speak into your life. And you have to be careful because God is not going to use just the up and in, but God told me to tell you that he's going to even use average people. He's going to use common people. So don't just look for those with the briefcase. Just be aware, friend and child of God, be aware of the divine connections that God is getting ready to set up in your life. He's surrounding you with people that is in position to take you to your place of destiny. They are already in position. They already know. It's kind of like Esther. The Bible says that Mordecai raised Esther. Amen. But when Esther got ready, before she could meet the king, the Bible says he said that there was a chamberlain that was set up in position already. Now, this chamberlain knew what the king liked. This chamberlain knew what pleases the king. He had been in the presence of the king, and so he was well aware of everything the king was looking for in a queen. And as Esther sat underneath his teaching, sat underneath his advice, sat underneath his administration, he was literally preparing her and instilling in her everything she needed to go before the king. The Bible says that everything that the chamberlain told Esther to do is what she did. When she came before the king to present herself, she followed the precise instructions of the chamberlain. Why? Because the chamberlain was already in a position to take her to her place of destiny. He had already been where she was trying to go. And the Bible says that when Esther came before the king, he stretched out the scepter and he received her and embraced her as his queen. And so now, child of God, God is literally setting you up and he's building a team around you, people that are already equipped to give you what you need to get to in the season of your life. Now, the Bible says here, amen, in the scriptures, it tells us in Genesis, the 37th chapter, talks about a man by the name of Joseph. And the Bible declares that Joseph was a dreamer. And many of us know Joseph. And so we're going to go out throughout Joseph's life, and we're going to see how that God has strategically set him up so that he can accomplish the dream that God had given him. Amen. Joseph being a dreamer, the Bible says that he has a dream. And Joseph sees the ending of his dream before he can even step into the beginning. He sees the ending of the dream, but he was unaware of the middle, the place in between, from where I am to where I'm going. Those things were hidden from him. He didn't understand the kind of adversity he was going to have to endure to get to see the fulfillment of his dream. And so the first battle that Joseph encounters was in his very own home. That's right, child of God. Sometimes, amen, the battle will be in your home. The battle will be around the people that is closest to you. The Bible says that Joseph encountered the battles in his own home. When he told his dream, it says that his parents didn't believe that it was possible. It says that his brothers hated him because of his dream. And they hated him so much so that they decided to kill the dream. Let me tell you, there are some people that are on an assignment. They see your potential and they can tell where you're headed, and the enemy will try to use them to sabotage the dream that God has given you. The Bible says here that while the brothers were out feeding the father's flock, it says that Joseph arrived on the scene. And the Bible says that they hated Joseph so much that when they saw him coming, they stripped him of his garment. You see, one thing the enemy wants to do is he wants to strip you. He wants to rob you of your dream. His garment represents his potential. It represented his mandate, his calling, his purpose. And so what the enemy would love to do is to strip you from your purpose, to strip you from the mandate and the God-ordained destiny for your life. And so the first thing they did was they stripped him. The second thing they did was they threw him in a pit. And the Bible says that this pit had no water. And what I love about this is that although the pit didn't have any water, which simply means that there was nothing there to sustain Joseph in this time. And sometimes it seems as if you're in a place, you had the dream, but it seems as if everything is going in reverse in your life. And you're in a place where it seems as if you don't have nothing that it takes to sustain the dream. You don't have the money it takes. You don't have the friends it takes. You don't know the people that it's going to take to sustain your dream and to bring your dream to pass. And so now here is this Joseph in a pit with no water, nothing to sustain him. But I can believe, amen, in my mind that Joseph has learned the secret on how to hold on to his dream irregardless. For the scripture declares that out of our own wells, we draw waters. And so I'm just led to believe that Joseph has learned how to drink waters out of his own well. In other words, Joseph has learned to encourage himself. He's learned to be encouraged even in the midst of his situation. He holds on to the dream. And I believe that the very thing that is keeping Joseph alive in this season is the dream that he has. He may be in a pit, but his dream is still alive. It seems as if there's nothing that is going to come out of his situation, but he's holding on to his dream. He's encouraging himself and he's drinking waters out of his own well. Amen. And so David says it like this. He says, I would have fainted lest I believe to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And there are some of you that's just holding on to a dream. You're holding on to a vision. You're holding on to something that God has showed you. And the thing that is keeping you going, keeping you standing, keeping you moving is the very dream that is locked up in your heart. Now, the Bible declares here that the third thing they do to Joseph is they sell him into Egypt. Genesis chapter 39 tells us about this scenario, how that Joseph is literally sold into Egypt. They don't know what to do with you. They want to take you out so bad that they don't know what to do with you. And so they just decided, we're going to get rid of him altogether. We're going to remove this dreamer out of our lives, because there are many people that are intimidated with the dream that's in your life. It hadn't even come to pass yet, but yet they are intimidated with what God is getting ready to do in your life. And so they take Joseph, they sell him off to Egypt, and Joseph ends up in the house of Potiphar's. He's in Potiphar's house now. And so now, although he's in Potiphar's house, the Bible says this, that the favor of God is on Joseph's life. It doesn't matter what he has gone through and what he has endured, God's signature of approval is on his life. And everywhere Joseph went, God caused him to prosper. God caused him to do well, to live above average, and caused him to excel. Because he had an excellent spirit, God caused him to excel everywhere he went. Because, amen, Joseph, amen, was walking in the will and the plan of God for his life. The favor of God was on his life in every circumstance. And so it says, even in Potiphar's house, God's favor is upon his life. So much so that Potiphar's sets him up as his personal assistant. And David is now over the house of Potiphar. He's over all of Potiphar's treasures and all of Potiphar's things. And he's in a high position in Potiphar's house. And the Bible says this, that Potiphar's wife saw the anointing on Joseph.